الحمد لله وكفى، والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والذين جاهدوا فينا لنهدينهم سبلنا، سبحان ربك رب العزة أما يصفون، والسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's infinite in His power and His ability. No one can compel anyone, no one can compel Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do a single thing. And in fact, whether we were created or whether we weren't created, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have remained and still remains the ultimate of all powers throughout the universe. One of the greatest mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He created creation altogether. Allah didn't have to create creation. He didn't have to produce an earth. He didn't have to produce animals. He didn't have to produce human beings. But He did so because He desired to be known. So if you read in Hadith, you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desired to be known, therefore He created creation. That desire to be known doesn't mean that it increased Allah's power in any way by creating creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remained, would have been the most powerful in the universe with or without our creation. He doesn't need our worship. But it was actually His infinite mercy that He desired to share His experience or His existence with other creation, or create a group of beings that would be able to enjoy His existence. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. Now if you look at the pathway of creation, you find that there are infinite mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us throughout that entire pathway. For example, first of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not even have to create creation at all. Allah remains powerful. He remains the most mighty, He remains the greatest, with or without our existence. So it's completely His mercy that He desired to create create creation and then to create us as well. So the first pathway was whether Allah should even create or not, and He created us, so that was a great blessing upon us. Then you look at the next step. Allah didn't have to create us as human beings. Allah could have created us as animals. He could have created me or you or any of us as any kind of animal. We could have been a dog. We could have been a cow. We could have been any type of animal in the entire universe. But instead of creating us in any other shape or form, it was Allah's infinite mercy that He decided to create you, each one of you, and me into the form of a human being. We didn't deserve to be human beings. We didn't do anything to earn that our nafs becomes a human being and another nafs becomes an animal. We didn't do anything to earn that right. That was just Allah's mercy upon us that He created us from the greatest of creation, meaning human beings. Then beyond that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have created us as people of religion or as people outside of religion. Again, we didn't do anything to deserve that this particular designation, that Allah created us not only as human beings, which is the greatest of creation, but then He also created us as a group of people who seek Him and who try to approach Him and who try to become nearer to Him. And when Allah divided creation into two parts, a group that would fill Jannah and another group that would fill Jahannam, it's His mercy that He put us in that group that is aiming to fill Jannah. How many people are out there who don't even know what religion is? They don't even think about the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you take it one step further. Not only did Allah decide to create us, and then not only did He create us as human beings, and then not only did He create us as people who seek Him, but then He also created us as Muslims, meaning He created us from the community of the greatest of all prophets. Such a community that all the other prophets, when they saw the benefits that were to be bestowed upon the Ummah of the Prophet, all of the prophets, not the people of the prophets, all of the prophets themselves made dua that, Ya Allah, make us from that ummah. So that's another great thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did for us. That He created us, then He made us human beings instead of animals, Then he made us people of religion, and of the people of the three religions, he made us among the Muslims who are the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then beyond that, we could have been average Muslims. We could have been Muslims who were Muslim by forefather but have no idea of what Islam is. Or we could have been Muslims who have left the deen. But he created us as Muslims who are seeking him and who are seeking our improvement. All of these things are incredible mercies of Allah. Just sit down and reflect for a second that there was a time when you were before Allah and you had to be chosen whether you would go to animal or human. And Allah ordained for you human. And then the next thing, imagine that moment when Allah is ordaining for you religious or non-religious. That's written by Allah, and He writes for you religion. And then you're before Allah, and He's deciding for you which of the three great religions, which of the prophets will you follow, and He puts you in the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All that is ordained by Allah. We didn't do anything. We didn't pay any amount of money to earn this or do any incredible act. It was all from the mercy of Allah. And so we should begin to appreciate what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us and how great His mercies are upon us and begin to take them very, very seriously. If you look in hadith, we learn that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to the Sahaba that on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take the richest person that lived in the universe. The richest person in the entire universe. Imagine, that person, if we took him just from this day and age, that person would be someone who probably has a private jet, probably eats anything he wants, anytime he wants, has everything he could ever desire, does anything he ever wants, basically lives his life the way he wants to. So Allah will take the richest person on the Day of Judgment, and He will take that person and dip them in hell for less than a second, a moment, according to hadith. And then He'll pull that person out. And He'll ask that person, did you ever experience anything good ever in your existence? And the person will say, I don't recall a single good thing ever happening to me in my existence. Meaning, despite his wealth, despite his luxury, despite living a life of his own desire, on the Day of Judgment, one moment of hellfire will be so predominant upon his state that he will completely forget everything that happened ever happened to him, and that will be the only thing that will predominate on his mind. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call another person. That person from creation who underwent the most hardship out of anyone, the most difficulties that ever befell any person, that person will be brought before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he for a moment, less than a second, lahba, just a moment, will be placed in the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will be taken out, and before all will be asked, did you ever experience a single difficulty in your existence? And the person will say, I never experienced any difficulty ever. Meaning the enjoyment of Jannah will be so dominant upon that person, will have such a dominant effect upon that person, that they will not even recall anything that happened to them prior to that moment. That's how dominant the effects of Jannah and Jahannam are on a human being. So we should begin to realize that just as we, on all these pathways, see there were all these pathways where we didn't have any say, where we ended up in the right category, now you stand at a place where you have a choice between two paths. Ultimately Allah has written it for you, but He's given you a choice here. So all the scheme and the whole flow chart, you had no choice, you ended up at this point, now there's two paths. And now you actually have a choice. So now, after all the blessings of Allah, where He's basically set everything up for you to make the right choice, now you have a choice, and the choice for you is not Islam or not Islam, because you've already come to that point. Your choice is where you'll be in the hereafter. There will be Muslims who will be put in Jahannam, albeit maybe for a moment. But that moment will be so dominant upon them that any hardship they underwent in the earth will be nothing compared to that moment. So now our choice here is, where are we going to go? Are we choosing a life of this world, which will perhaps lead us to sometime in Jahannam in the hereafter, or will we choose the life of the hereafter? This is what our predecessors worked at. This was their point of differentiation. This is where they said, okay, now we have to choose this path, and they focused themselves completely upon it. So we have to begin to take our time here extremely seriously. Nothing matters if you undergo a little bit of hardship here. So you have to choose Islam, so you have to choose to pray five times a day, but it means you have just a little bit less of a salary. You have to choose a career that perhaps is not as luxurious in this world, but at least it'll make your hair after. So what? So what if you don't get that degree that you always dreamed of, but at least you keep your five prayers alive? So what? What difference will it make? And you're not going to remember it. You didn't remember any of your previous lives. How many of you will stand up and say, well, I'm so lucky that I had wealthy parents. I lived very comfortably when I was in the stomach of my mom. No one will stand up and say that. There are some people who lived with wealthy parents. They lived in comfortable houses. They lived with AC and with heat while they were in the stomachs of their mothers. They ate good food through their mother. And there are other people in this world who basically grew up in the third world, and they underwent extreme hardships while they were in the stomach of their mother. Nobody remembers that life. Despite the fact that while you're in the womb of your mother, not only are you created, not only do you have pain sensation and all these other things, but Allah has also put your ruh in you after 40 days. After 120 days. There's a period of time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually puts your ruh in you and you can experience what's going on. You don't remember being crushed up in some small dark place, basically floating in fluid in the stomach of your mother. Nobody remembers that, despite the fact that you were there for 9 months. So that's because you went to the next world, you forgot everything when you came here. And in the same way, when you wake up on the Day of Judgment, you won't remember a thing from this world, except the general impression of what you did, because you'll see its results before you. And we're going to wake up naked, we are going to wake up weeping. And we'll wake up scared to death, because that's when the reality will hit us. So this is the opportunity for us to take advantage of all these blessings that Allah gathered within us, that He created us, and then we're healthy, and we're Muslims, and we're from the Ummah of the Prophet ﷺ. All of these things are incredible blessings upon us, and we should begin to realize that this life of this world is very, very short and transient. And what's really going to matter is the Day of Judgment. And it's not the time of the Day of Judgment that's as big of a deal, but it's how deep it is, in the sense that even a moment in the Jannah of Allah will wipe out anything you experienced in this world, even a moment. And Allah is not promising you a moment; He's promising you the entire length of time, as it exists, which is infinite for Allah. So we're not being promised a moment in Jannah if you do A, B, and C, which would have been worth it. If Allah would have said, pray five times a day, fast, and do all these things, then I'll put you in my Jannah for one moment, that's it, it would have been worth it. But Allah took you beyond that. Not only does He promise to put you in His Jannah, but then He promises to put you in there forever, and then He bestows all these extra ni'mah upon you, depending upon your level. Like the vision of Allah, all the different rewards that He gives to the people in Jannah, meetings with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, etc. So these are all extra things which we have not even thought about. So begin to realize that this life means nothing. And we do not prefer this life over anything. When you make a decision, that's how you make decisions. People always wonder, well, what degree should I choose? How should I make my daily schedule? Who should I hang around with? What should I do? Just put this in front of you. Every single decision you make, put it in front of you. Is it for the akhirah or is it for this world? If it's for this world, fine. So long as you stay within the bounds of the Sharia. But if there's a single chance that you will move outside of the bounds of the Sharia, in any decision you ever make, back off and say it's not worth it. No matter what can be bestowed upon you, it's not worth it. You have your health, you're fairly wealthy living in this particular place of the world, you're fairly wealthy living in this particular time. So you've experienced everything you need to experience, now you need to make those decisions for the Akhirah, because otherwise it's going to be a very, very sad day when we stand before our Lord. So, we should begin to take our time seriously. That's the fundamental message. And we should begin to appreciate the incredible mercies of Allah upon us. Really, they're infinite. Just sit down and start thinking. Even just the fact that He didn't create us as an animal. He could have. He could have easily. And it would make no difference to Him. If you just reflect upon that, that's enough to show you how great the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon us. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. What we usually do for about 20 more minutes is very, very short dhikr. It's all ayats from the Qur'an or from the ahadith. I'll recite the line to you. You can recite it to yourself silently. Auzubillah. When you hear the word salawat, it means that you send salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam silently. Auzubillahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Salawat.